חשבנו כשבנינו את יום העיון, כי יש כל כך הרבה אספקטים שאפשר לדבר עליהם בדיאגנוזה, שאי אפשר להימנע מהקשר בין האמנות הישראלית והבינלאומית, ליחס המורכב של האמנות הישראלית החדשה או הצעירה, עם הדרישה ההולכת ומתהווה להתערות בעולם, להתערות במרחב הבינלאומי. ולכן הדובר שלנו עכשיו בעצמו נמצא בין שני העולמות, sorry, I'm speaking in Hebrew, you should, you understand. ניקולה טרצי, שהגיע ארצה מאיטליה, הוא ניהל מספר שנים את התוכנית ללימודי תואר שני בבצלאל, במקביל הוא שימש עורך מגזין פלשארט, הוא עצר בקרן הביאנל של פראג, בפאלה דה טוקיו ופריז, במרכזי אומנות עכשווית נוספים בעולם, כיום הוא מנהל את המרכז אומנות עכשווית CCA, והוא בעצם בעצמו דוגמה למייצג את שני העולמות, אבל הוא ידבר עכשיו על איך הוא רואה את האומנות הישראלית הצעירה מתמודדת עם הזר, עם האחר, והוא מעדיף לדבר באנגלית. So I invite you, Nicola, to...
I'm very happy to be here. I feel like a real guest in the Abayt Omanut Israelit. The Italians, they move too much their hands. I'm learning how to understand Israeli art, and I've done actually a project that just closed a few days ago, and maybe I'll be very fast in my presentation, so then maybe we can have questions, I hope. I don't know, Edith, you'll tell me if you do like this, we stop, okay? So when I spoke to Edith, she actually sent me a few questions about how would I react to the situation here, the landscape, the artistic landscape, and I actually thought the questions were very interesting. So I'm trying to respond to the questions that I received, but before I just say a few words about the title, Disproportion or Abundance, the Israeli Ecosystem and its Uniquenesses. What I mean with this, I will say it in few words. I believe, and this is one of the reasons I decided to move to Tel Aviv to work for Bezalel from New York, where I was working for Flash Art as an editor. I was here several times, always for work, to work with artists or to write about exhibitions, or always connected to the field. And I always felt the scene was very, very, very vibrant. I've always met great artists. At the same time, I felt that the system maybe could benefit from maybe some other perspectives. And when I write about disproportion or abundance, I mean that I think in Israel, compared to the size of the country and the history of the country, there's a large number of good artists. And this is, if we try to compare, and I've been traveling a bit when I was working for the magazine, I was always amazed that you could meet so many good artists that were doing fantastic work, but at the same time, the more I was coming, the more I was realizing that there were not enough private galleries to take these artists, and even the few ones that are here, they have such a tough life. I mean, we're not gonna get into what it means to run a commercial gallery in Israel. This is would take a long time. And not enough museums, not enough philanthropists or collectors that would make the life of the artist and the gallery and the museum easier. So when I mean disproportion or abundance, and when I look at the Israeli ecosystem, like, you know, if we look at an ecosystem with all the animals, you know, who, like, is it, on one hand, I see abundance because there are a lot of good artists. On the other side, I see disproportion, because when you have too much in an ecosystem, when you have too much of one animal, then the whole ecosystem is not balanced, and there can be issues. And actually, that's why I selected this work. It's a work by Jan Tichy, who is a Czech-born, Chicago-based Israeli artist, let's put it this way. It's a bit complicated with him. I mean, he was born in Czech Republic. He came to Israel to study in Musrara, and then he did his MFA at Bezalel, when Nahum Tevet was the head of the department, and then he did a second master in the School of the Art Institute in Chicago, and he stayed as a faculty. And I think now he's even tenure track in School of the Art Institute. This is a work, it's a series of photographs. Jan's work is truly connected to the history of the medium of photography. I will say it in one sentence, because it, again, it will take much longer. But this is a set of photographs that he did with the Tel Aviv Bats. It's in the collection of the Museum of Modern Art in New York. And again, I wanted to use this because usually one of the best examples to explain disproportion ecosystems is when pollution makes bats dying and then mosquitoes increase in number disproportionately. And then we suffer, we human beings, because we get a lot of bites and we suffer. And if we had less pollution and more bats, it would be much better. Okay, so first question that I receive is Israeli artists and the international art scene. And I add from Edith's question a summary. This I just made, you'll see it's wow, okay, I don't see my notes, so I'll go by memory. Please forgive me if I say, if I have some wrong information. The first work is Barber Ula by Sigalit Landau, to the left. Following is a work by Mika Rottenberg. I don't remember the title, I apologize. The third one is a one shot from a series by Yael Bartana, where she's dressing like Theodor Herzl. Then below the Mika Rottenberg is Video Art Manual, which is a very iconic work by Karen Sitter. And the last one is Makom, which is a site-specific installation by Michal Rovner at the courtyard of the Louvre in Paris. Now, if we look at this, and I would say just like the pyramid of the Louvre, it's just the tip of the iceberg. I can continue naming you Israeli artists. I did it all women, because it's we at CCA, for instance, we make a statement that there are so many amazing Israeli female artists that, you know, we want to support. But I could have continued naming the Israeli artists that are completely part of the international scene. I always made a joke that you can do a whole Venice Biennial only with the Israeli artists that are showing everywhere. So, going back to what I said before, there is very, very good material. And I believe that there's not even a question of how the Israeli artists are in the international, like, it just, we just need to see that they are there and they are showing. And it's, I compare, for instance, to my home country, Italy, like, we are in much, much worse condition. If we would do like a proportion of how many Italian artists are invited to biennials versus Israelis, with the boycott, with all the problems, with the lack of galleries, with the lack of support, you would see that Israel is doing much, much better. Second question, what is the ability of Israeli art to respond to social and political issues? Okay, this is a little bit more difficult. And in order to kind of flip somehow in a Dada way Edith's question, I put a painting of Avner Bengal, also to counterbalance the female, all-female previous slide. This is a work called Belzebub. It's a painting. I sometimes, not all the time, but sometimes I feel that the social and political, because we live in a place that has very specific social and political fabric. I mean, I'm the last one to try to explain or understand. I mean, but for sure I see a lot of complexity, and this is also one of the reasons I wanted to move here. I felt that as somebody who decided not to have a day job, but rather to have a job that is a little bit more complex and engages me on all aspects of my life, I felt that Israel could have been an interesting way to bring this all the way, because if you live in New York or if you live now Europe, and New York, they're also getting very much polarized. But let's say when I moved here 5 years ago, and I was living in New York with Barack Obama, and everybody was so happy, you know, I felt maybe I should be in a place where I'm forced to ask myself questions all the time, rather than just forget, you know. And I think here every day you need to think more than anywhere else. And anyway, my response is that I do not, I believe Israel has a great, Israeli art has great capability to respond to social and political issues, but sometimes I'm afraid that the response become a little bit too much of a, let's say, too much of a direct response. I'm more into, you know, retroactive answers or things that don't come straight to you, or this idea of, you know, the so-called political art always sounds a little bit strange to me, okay? I think all, I'll say something so banal, but I truly believe that every good art should be political in one way or another, and that's why I want to bring the medium that is usually the least, unless it's the Guernica of Picasso in the United Nations. We don't think of painting as political, but I do think that there's a way, maybe this is one of the issues, maybe the lack of infrastructure sometimes creates this situation where Israeli artists are tempted to take the political and the social in a too much direct way. And I believe, again, there is way more complexity to that, and also to look at the artist in the full spectrum, not going only to this, and this is maybe an argument we did it. I'm not sure I would bring these terms in a presentation of art that I would do, because I just think they come anyway. These are pillars. You know, it's we don't even need to speak, because every good artwork will trigger political, social issues as much as forms and colors and, you know, and concepts. So, but I really wanted to respond. So I don't need to explain who is Belzebub, right? Everybody knows?
Belzebub.
Yeah, we all know? Is this creature, this, you know, friend of Satan? You know, this is I don't know how you say it in Hebrew. Yeah, okay. I'm alliterating it with the Latin alphabet. It's the same in English and in Italian, and I believe, I don't know how you say it in Hebrew, but. Okay. You see, lost in translation. Okay, so this is. Last slide I want to discuss before maybe somebody has a few questions or we just close, because I don't even know how much time I have left. I see like not 5 minutes, okay. This is a large painting by Zoya Cherkasky, who is an artist born in the Ukraine, who moved, I believe, as a teenager after the fall of the USSR to Israel, and she has been working here since then. It's a work, I will try to remember the title. I think it says summer 90 something in the projects and winter blah 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 in Kiev, okay? It's a diptych, very large diptych. It is part of the collection of the Israel Museum in Jerusalem, and it was exhibited twice in the museum for a group exhibition curated by the then contemporary art curator Rita Kersting. It was called The Distance of a Day, and then it was exhibited in Zoya's solo exhibition at the museum a few years later. Why I'm showing this work? Because Edith asked me, what are the difficulties Israeli artists face outside? So I wanted to say that I do not really believe in its inside and outside in a way. I mean, there is an inside and an outside, but I believe we live in a time where these two opposites can always blend, and I think we need to, again, I want to shift the attention not to the artist, but maybe to the museum at this point. This show, Zoya, in the Israel Museum was a great exhibition with a great public. And when I went to visit it, I've known Zoya for some time. I've worked with the New Barbizon, which is a group of painters she's the leader of, I would say. I was so sad when I left the exhibition, because I felt this exhibition could speak to so many people outside of Israel. And I was amazed that there was no plan to make this exhibition going anywhere else. Just as the painting says, you know, this, it's never one place or the other place, it's the two places at the same, it's the inside and the outside at the same time. And as a matter of fact, when Zoya had a little solo show in New York, in a gallery that, even though I lived there 7 years, I never heard of, she got an amazing review by Roberta Smith, who, okay, I'm finished, who is the main art critic for the New York Times and a real institution. So why, my question is, if we have so many good artists and we also have good museums, why there's no push to the outside? And there are some answers. I think people are starting to realize that, I will just mention, you know, I think Artis, which is a philanthropic organization that has been supporting artists, especially in this idea of going abroad, I think now they are more and more realizing that if you only help one animal in the ecosystem and you don't help all the animals in the ecosystem, actually the ecosystem doesn't become balanced. It stays unbalanced and not healthy. So this is my response. If you have to help all the partners, it's not only about the artist, it's about the artist, the curator, the museum director, the gallerist. So somehow when she asked me about the outside, I think Israeli artists have no problem going outside. But if I'm the only one going outside and all the others, like me, who runs a little institution, or we have other museums, a museum that stay here, and there's no, you basically, you know, you just make one part of the machine. It's like repairing only the wheels of the car, and the engine is broken. The car will not go.
Thank you. Of course.